Global approval of the U.S. foreign policy, of course, has taken a hit during the Trump presidency, illustrated starkly in this Gallup poll, which paints the picture from 2012 onwards. But could the deal between Israel and the UAE mark a shift? For more on what we could expect, I'm joined by Middle East scholar Vali Nasr, professor at the Johns Hopkins School of International Studies, and former member of the European Parliament, Marietje Schaake. Welcome, both of you, to the program. Vali, because you know this region so well, I wonder what your thoughts are about this peace deal, what you've heard Jared Kushner say tonight, what you've just heard Anwar Gargash say, where it leaves the region as a whole.
Well, the region as a whole will not see much change because the Israeli-UAE, Israeli-Saudi relationship has been there for some time. It has been an open secret that there are intelligence, military, and diplomatic ties between them. Now it's been formalized, and largely this has been formalized because not because of the region, but because it benefits all the parties at this moment in time. President Trump desperately needs a foreign policy victory. North Korea hasn't panned out. With China, things are going sideways. He has not been able to get Iran to the negotiating table. This way, he can basically claim a victory, and it's a victory that will be popular with evangelical voters in the United States, and he needs that. Prime Minister Netanyahu is a big winner. He's facing corruption charges. He really could not go forward with annexation. And for him, this is a wonderful victory. He can tell Israelis that there is no trade-off between being aggressive on the Palestinian issue and normalizing relations with Israel. And he's now historically important in having established diplomatic ties with a third Arab country. And for UAE, I think there is a worry more about Washington than is about Iran. We know that UAE and Saudi Arabia got very close to the Trump administration, that they are worried about a democratic backlash when a new administration comes in, or if the Congress becomes even more democratic. The progressive wing of the Democratic Party is very critical of the war in Yemen. And a good news of peace building with Israel in the Middle East will help cushion some of the blow that they might expect after the election. And I think all of them sort of saw this moment as necessary to come forward and try to take maximum advantage of this deal. But on the ground, it doesn't change anything between UAE and Iran. It doesn't change the lay of the land in Syria. It doesn't change Libya. It just formalizes what has already been there as an axis of cooperation between the Persian Gulf Emirates and Israel.
Really interesting to get that perspective. Marietje Schaake, let me ask you from the European perspective, because we have had European leaders react to this deal. We've had them praise the deal, but with the condition, of course, as Mr. Gargash was talking about, of using it as an ability or a method to restart negotiations between Israel and Palestine for a two-state solution. Do you see that as possible? And how much does that mean now still for Europe?
Well, I think it is definitely still the priority for the European Union. And I encourage leaders to be more active in the geopolitical sphere and especially in the Middle East. And it is clear that with everything that's already happening in the Middle East, the last thing people there, but also the EU need is more instability, more conflict, and more polarization. And so I think that should be the priority for European leaders. And it is unfortunate that the United States under President Trump has become much less of a reliable partner there. We've seen the surprise withdrawal of troops from Syria, but also the walking away from the Iran nuclear deal, which, even if it was sold in the United States as a big success or a necessary step, was really perceived as a big disappointment and a slap in the face for Europeans who were deeply invested in that, and where we still see the instability and the tensions that have come from the U.S. Not adhering to the deal. And that, for a president that, you know, promises and actually prides himself in being a deal maker, shows that there's a lot of deal breaking going on as well.
Well, so let me ask you, Marietje, before I go back to Vali, on the Iran nuclear deal, because that was one of the hallmark things that President Trump said he was going to get out of when he came into office, and he did. What impact is it having on Europe? And does it make you feel safer, less safe? And do you hope that if there is another administration, a new administration, that somehow there's enough of it that can be stitched back together or a deal plus?
Well, it is clear that the EU, along with many global partners, was actually very invested in this diplomatic deal with the Obama administration as well. And so even if it was announced, it was still very disappointing and I think harmful for the perspective of allowing diplomatic negotiations between global powers to render success. And so we've seen European leaders scrambling to cushion the fallout of the US walking away, for example, by economic instruments. And there's still ongoing questions about the extension of the arms embargo playing out at the UN as we speak. So definitely Europeans will look with great hope to a new administration, if that indeed is elected, to renegotiate diplomatically with the Iranians. And I can only hope that it will not be too late, because not only will the Middle East suffer more than it already does, but also the EU will be the first to feel the effects of further escalation and militarization of any conflict in the Middle East.
So, Vali, let me ask you, because you know this deal, you know, just about as well as anybody does. And we're hearing reports that members of the Trump administration, either, you know, in the open or behind the scenes, are trying to do everything they can to make sure that coming out of the deal is irreversible, hedging their bets in case he should lose and tying a future president's hands. What future do you see for any deal on at this level with a new administration?
Well, I think whether President Trump gets reelected or there's a new administration, I think the current situation with Iran cannot continue. The United States has shown that it can exert enormous amount of pressure on a country as well as on its allies, but it cannot force a change in the policy of that country. And I think the problem with President Trump has been that he has said that he wants a new deal with Iran, but in reality, he has behaved like he wants regime change. And that has destroyed any trust in what U.S. intentions might be. So I think a new administration would have to basically try to reconstitute trust in American policy, not Iranian trust in American policy, but also European, Chinese, and Russian trust in American policy. And I think one of the problems is that we don't know how much damage will be done between now and January. I mean, as we're talking today, the United States is launching its resolution at the United Nations to try to force an extension of arms embargo on Iran over European, Chinese, and Russian objections. And essentially running roughshod over the Security Council rules, over multilateral policies. So in a way, you know, the U.S. objective now is very simple, which is that the current deal has to break apart. It hasn't over the past 4 years, to force Iran to sign a new deal. But it actually doesn't have a pathway of how it gets there. I think the Biden administration, as it said, will try to go back to the deal, at least as a ground level baseline, from which they can then think about how do you get Iran back into negotiations about other things, and how do you get the Europeans, Chinese, and the Russians to support an American policy.